The skin of the upper limb is supplied by 15 sets of cutaneous nerves. Out of this, only one set, that is the supraclavicular, that is originated from the cervical plexus. Cervical plexus, one set, that is a supraclavicular. Next, the intercostal brachial nerve is derived from the second intercostal nerve. Second intercostal nerve giving rise to intercostal brachial nerve. And the remaining 13 is coming out of the brachial plexus. So brachial plexus is the major contributor or largest contributor. And the sets that are coming from the brachial plexus are supplying through the musculocutaneous, median, ulnar, axillary and radial nerves. And some branches arise directly from the medial cord of the plexus. So sources are cervical plexus, second intercostal nerve and the brachial plexus. Next, we will get to know the name of the individual nerves. So first we describe about the arm, then forearm, palm, and the rest of the region will be described. Regarding arm, first we go to the arm, both the anterior aspect and posterior aspect. Now, in the arm, in the anterior aspect, the upper lateral part of the arm in the anterior aspect is supplied by the upper lateral cutaneous nerve of arm. And it is derived from the axillary nerve. Then coming to the lower lateral part, lower lateral part of the front of the arm, that is supplied by the lower lateral cutaneous nerve of arm. So it is supplied by, there is a similarity in the name, lower lateral cutaneous nerve of arm. So upper lateral part by the upper lateral cutaneous nerve, lower lateral part by the lower lateral cutaneous nerve. And this lower lateral cutaneous nerve of arm is derived from radial nerve. The upper lateral one was derived from axillary nerve and lower lateral from the radial nerve. Okay. Then we are going to the medial aspect on the front of the arm. Upper medial part and the lower medial part. The upper medial part it is supplied by the intercostobrachial nerve. And the lower medial part by the medial cutaneous nerve of arm. That is coming from the medial cord of brachial plexus. So anterior aspect of the or frontal aspect of the arm has been described. Now we are going to the posterior aspect of the arm. Now if you look at the posterior aspect of the arm, then we will see that the posterior part, okay, is supplied by the posterior cutaneous nerve. This is the posterior part of the arm, and it is supplied by, let us clear the other parts. Posterior part of arm is supplied by posterior cutaneous nerve of arm, which is a branch of radial nerve. So that is about the nerve supply of the arm. Coming to the forearm, let's see. In the forearm, in the anterior aspect, the lateral side is supplied by the lateral medial lateral. The lateral side is supplied by lateral cutaneous nerve of forearm. And it is a branch of musculocutaneous nerve. Whereas the medial side is supplied by medial cutaneous nerve of forearm. And it is a branch from the medial cord of brachial plexus. On the posterior aspect, posterior side of the forearm is supplied by posterior cutaneous nerve of forearm. Which is a branch of radial nerve. Okay, so this is the nerve supply of the arm, both on the anterior aspect and on the posterior aspect. Next, we are shifting onto the shoulder and pectoral region. In the upper part of the pectoral region, shoulder region, and skin over the upper part of the deltoid, both anteriorly and posteriorly, the upper shoulder region, upper pectoral region, and skin over upper part of deltoid is supplied by supraclavicular nerve. It is in the shoulder, upper part of the deltoid. And pectoral, upper pectoral. The supraclavicular nerve is a branch from the cervical plexus. Having a root value of C3, C4. Okay. The palm is supplied on the lateral two-third. This is the lateral two-third. This is the lateral two-third of the palm. By the palmar cutaneous branch of median nerve. Median nerve and on the medial one-third this part by the palmar cutaneous branch of ulnar nerve. Regarding the dorsum of the hand on the opposite side of the palm, it is supplied by first the medial half. So, medial half of the dorsum of the hand, including proximal and middle phalanx of medial 2.5 digits. This part is supplied by dorsal branch of ulnar nerve. And shifting onto the lateral side, the lateral half, including proximal and middle phalanx of lateral 2.5 digits. It is supplied by the superficial terminal branch of radial nerve. Superficial terminal branch of radial nerve. Okay. Now coming to the digits. Now digit has palmar aspect and dorsal aspect. Okay. Now we consider them both as follows. The palmar aspect and the dorsal aspect of distal phalanx of lateral 3.5 digits. What did I say? The palmar aspect, what I am drawing now, is the palmar aspect and dorsal aspect of distal phalanx. Okay. and the dorsal aspect of distal phalanx. Dorsal aspect of distal phalanx. Once again, palmar aspect and the dorsal aspect of distal phalanx. Of the lateral 3.5 digits. Of lateral 3.5 digits is supplied by palmar digital branch of median nerve. Okay, now regarding the palmar aspect and dorsal aspect of distal phalanx of medial 1.5 digit. So I'm drawing now the outline of, let me enlarge, the palmar aspect of medial 1.5 digit. Plus dorsal aspect of distal phalanx of medial 1.5 digit. Okay. Is it clear what I said? Palmar aspect and dorsal aspect of distal phalanx of medial 1.5 digits is supplied by the palmar digital branch of ulnar nerve. Palmar digital branch of ulnar nerve. That is the supply of the digits. Okay. So summing it all up, we get the 15 nubs. Let's see what are these 15 sets of cutaneous nubs that are supplying the superior extremity. Let's start from the beginning. The upper part of pectoral region and skin over upper part of the deltoid is supplied by supraclavicular nerve, which is having a root value of C3-C4 and derived from cervical plexus. Then coming to the arm, the upper medial part by the intercostal brachial nerve, that is root value of T2 and derived from second intercostal nerve. The lower medial part is derived from medial cutaneous nerve of arm having a root value of T1-T2 and derived from medial cord of brachial plexus. Now coming to the upper lateral and lower lateral parts, the upper lateral part including skin over lower part of deltoid
is supplied by upper lateral cutaneous nerve of arm, which is derived from the axillary nerve, whereas lower lateral part, that is supplied by the lower lateral cutaneous nerve of arm, it is supplied by radial nerve. So these are often asked, the upper lateral and lower lateral part of the arm. The posterior aspect, posterior cutaneous nerve of arm, derived from radial nerve. So these three, upper lateral, lower lateral, and the posterior cutaneous nerve of arm, they are derived from axillary nerve, radial nerve, and radial nerve respectively. Shifting on to the side of the forearm, the medial side of the forearm by medial cutaneous nerve of forearm, derived from medial cord. The lateral side of forearm by lateral cutaneous nerve of forearm, that is derived from the musculocutaneous nerve. Whereas the posterior side of the forearm is supplied by posterior cutaneous nerve of forearm, derived from radial nerve. And regarding palm, the lateral two-third palmar cutaneous branch of median nerve from the median nerve, and medial one-third palmar cutaneous branch of ulnar nerve from ulnar. Dorsum of the hand, medial half including proximal and middle phalanges of medial 2.5 digits, dorsal branch of ulnar from ulnar, and dorsal branch of ulnar, and lateral half including proximal and middle phalanges of lateral 2.5 digit, that is from the radial. Regarding the supply of the digits, we can see that palmar aspect and dorsal aspect of distal phalanges, the lateral 3.5 digits by palmar digital branch of median nerve from median nerve, and medial 1.5 digit from palmar digital branch of ulnar nerve from the ulnar nerve. So that is in a nutshell the nerve supply of the upper limb. That is a cutaneous nerve supply of the upper limb. Thank you. Let us first discuss about what is a dermatome. The dermatome is an area of skin supplied by one spinal nerve. So it is an area of skin supplied by one spinal nerve or spinal segment. In this diagram, for example, the C3, C4, T2, etc., all of them refers to the area of skin supplied by the third cervical, fourth cervical, or second thoracic spinal nerves. So basically the alphabetical numeral numbers here refers to the number of spinal nerve or spinal segment that is supplying the overlying skin in that area. So area of skin, basically dermatome is an area of skin supplied by a spinal nerve or spinal segment. Okay, so when I talk about, say, C6 dermatome, what I mean is that the area of skin that is supplied by C6 spinal nerve, supplied by sixth cervical spinal nerve. So that is the dermatome. Now the dermatomes of our upper limb, human upper limb, they are distributed in an orderly numerical sequence and along two borders, preaxial and postaxial. Preaxial and postaxial, what are they? Okay, let's move on to another diagram. It is a diagram of the embryo. okay, embryo. Now the embryo develops limb buds. It's an upper limb bud, it is a lower limb bud. Now both the limb bud, say for example the upper limb bud, in this case the upper limb bud has two borders, upper border and lower border. Okay, the upper border or cephalic border or cephalic border, upper border of upper limb bud or cephalic border upper border of upper limb bud is also known as preaxial border, and the lower or caudal border is known as the post axial border. In the adults, the preaxial border and post axial border are as follows. In the adult, the preaxial border is this. This is the preaxial border. In an adult. And the postaxial border is on the medial side. Okay. Preaxial border and postaxial border. Now the dermatomes are distributed along the preaxial border by the segments, following segments, segment C3, C4, C5, C6, and on the postaxial, along the postaxial border via segment C8, T1 and T2. In between these two areas, the middle three digits, this region is supplied by the C7 segment. Okay, so altogether we can see that the dermatomes of the upper limb are C3, C4, C5, C6, C7, C8, T1, T2 or C3 to T2. That is the dermatome. Okay. Now, as I have already told you about the preaxial and postaxial border, the preaxial and postaxial border is the lateral and medial borders. So, lateral is the preaxial border and medial is the postaxial border. So, if you are asked that along which border the radius is lying, so radius is on the lateral side, you know, radius bone is on the lateral side, that means it is lying along the preaxial border. Similarly, thumb is on the lateral side, so along the preaxial border, whereas ulna will be on the medial side or postaxial border, so is the little finger. So thumb along the preaxial border along with radius, and the little finger along with the ulna is along the postaxial border. So these are the question often asked. So radius is the preaxial bone and ulna is the postaxial bone. One thing that is very important is that there is a varying degree of overlapping of adjoining dermatomes. Okay, so that you have to remember, there is varying degree of overlapping of adjacent dermatomes. Okay, the axillary nerve is one of the five major nerves of the upper limb. The other four major nerves are median nerve, then radial nerve, ulnar nerve, and musculocutaneous nerve. The axillary nerve is formed from brachial plexus in the axilla. The brachial plexus is a neuronal network. And it is formed of roots, trunks, divisions, and cords. If we take an enlarged view of brachial plexus, we can clearly see that the organization of brachial plexus is proximodistally, is in the form of like this. These are the roots, 1, 2, 3. 4 and 5 roots of brachial plexus. The roots lead to the formation of trunks. Each of the trunk divide twice to form the divisions. Let us draw the posterior division with the blue and anterior division with the red. So each trunk is undergoing division into anterior and posterior division, and these divisions unite in particular manner to give rise to three chords. So roots are 5 in number, trunks are 3. Each of the trunk is divided into anterior and posterior division, 3 into 2, 6 divisions, and they lead up to the formation of three chords. Okay. Now the three chords are named as lateral, medial, and the posterior chord. We'll talk about the posterior chord with regard to the axillary nerve, because axillary nerve arises from the posterior chord. So it is arising from the posterior cord of brachial plexus with a root value of C5, C6. Okay. Now the roots of brachial plexus are from C5, C6, C7, C8 and T1 spinal nerves. All these values actually refer to either C5, C6, C7, C8, T1, all these are referring to the ventral rami of corresponding spinal nerve. So axillary nerve is formed by the fibers that travel through the ventral rami of C5 and C6 spinal nerve. So the root value is C5 and C6. Ventral rami of spinal nerves. Okay. Now it is forming from the posterior cord that we have established. Now let's understand this muscle first, the muscle outline first. This is the outline of subscapularis muscle. And here lies the posterior cord. Posterior cord of brachial plexus. Now the axillary nerve is taking its origin from the posterior cord and run backward on the subscapularis. So let's draw the axillary nerve. It is running above the subscapularis backward. And you can see that it is passing through an opening, right? That opening has a roughly quadrangular outline. It is called quadrangular space. Through that opening, the axillary nerve is going into the back of the surgical neck of the humerus. Let's draw the humerus over here, then it will be very clear. The outline of humerus is as follows. This is the shaft of the humerus. This region is the surgical neck of the humerus. Axillary nerve is passing behind the surgical neck via the quadrangular space. So let's see another picture. Look, this is the quadrangular space outline. And the axillary nerve is passing through it to the back of the surgical neck. This is the surgical neck of humerus, and the outline of axillary nerve, as you can see, shown in faint yellow. It is on the back of the surgical neck, passing through a quadrangular opening over in this region that is called the quadrangular space. Okay. Now, if we see the diagram from the back, we can greatly appreciate the coming out of the axillary nerve. Let's see the same diagram from the back. This is the axillary nerve coming to the back of the surgical neck. We are seeing the posterior aspect. This muscle above is the teres minor. Below, this muscle is the teres major. This area I have already told you, that is the region of the surgical neck, and let's clear it. This muscle outline blue colored, it is the long head of triceps. So the quadrangular space have a boundary of teres minor above, teres minor above, teres major below, surgical neck of humerus laterally, and the long head of triceps medially. So that is the boundary of the quadrangular space, and through that quadrangular space the axillary nerve is coming out along with this vessel, which is called posterior circumflex humeral vessel. Or posterior circumflex humeral artery, which is a branch of axillary artery. Let's again go back to the previous diagram. Let's see the axillary artery. Axillary artery is the major artery of the axilla, having a curved course. And the axillary artery, okay, is beginning from the outer border of first rib to the lower border of teres major. Okay. Now, axillary artery is divided into three parts by this muscle. This is the outline of a triangular muscle which is called the pectoralis minor. The pectoralis minor is dividing the axillary artery into three parts. The first part is from the outer border of first rib to the muscle. Second part is behind the pectoralis minor, and third part is beyond the pectoralis minor. So axillary artery is divided into three parts by pectoralis minor muscle. From the third part, three branches come out, among which one is the posterior circumflex humeral artery. The artery which accompanies the axillary nerve onto the back of the surgical neck. So let's see the artery. This is the outline of anterior circumflex humeral, and this is in dotted line is the outline of posterior circumflex humeral artery that embraces the posterior part of the surgical neck of humerus in accompaniment with the axillary nerve. Sorry, I must show both of them in dotted lines because both of them are passing behind the surgical neck. Okay. Axillary nerve, posterior circumflex humeral artery, which is a branch of third part of axillary artery. Yeah. Okay. Now, when the axillary nerve is passing through the quadrangular space, the nerve gives a branch to the shoulder joint. So, over at this region, when it's passing through the quadrangular space, it is giving a branch to shoulder joint. Shoulder joint is a joint between the head of the humerus and the glenoid cavity of scapula. Okay. So axillary nerve gives a branch to the shoulder joint while passing through the quadrangular space. When the axillary nerve is passing through the quadrangular space into the back of the surgical neck and winding around it, it is under cover of the deltoid muscle. If we take a section at the level of the quadrangular space, a transverse section like this, passing through the quadrangular space, section is cutting through the quadrangular space actually. Okay, then how the cross section will look like? This is the transverse section, the cross section of humerus, deltoid. This is the axillary artery, main trunk, giving a posterior circumflex humeral artery. And this is the axillary nerve passing along with the posterior circumflex humeral artery in the quadrangular space. Okay. Now it divides into an anterior division and posterior division. It divides into an anterior division and a posterior division. When it was passing through the quadrangular space, so it was giving a branch to the shoulder joint. A branch was given to the shoulder joint. Now, immediately after it gives a branch to the shoulder joint, it divides into an anterior division and a posterior division. The anterior branch continues horizontally. It is continuing horizontally between the deltoid and surgical neck of humerus. Deltoid back, and in front there is the surgical neck. That is the anterior division. Along with the posterior circumflex humeral artery. And it supplies the deltoid. See? It is supplying the deltoid. And sends a few branches through the deltoid. Through the deltoid, the branch is coming out onto the overlying skin. There is a skin. Now that is the fate of the anterior branch. Coming to the posterior branch, what happened? There is a posterior branch. The posterior branch supplies teres minor and posterior part of deltoid. It is supplying posterior part of deltoid, and there is a branch to the muscle teres minor. Okay. It then continues after supplying the teres minor on the over the posterior border of the deltoid as upper lateral cutaneous nerve or arm. Let's do a sum up on the axillary nerve. Axillary nerve is derived from the posterior cord of brachial plexus. Which is coming out from the C5 and C6 roots. And then passes on the posterior wall of axilla above the subscapularis. And thereafter runs through the quadrangular space. The quadrangular space is related very intimately with the surgical neck of humerus. This is the surgical neck, and this is the outline of the quadrangular space. While running through this quadrangular space, the axillary nerve, which run in very intimate contact with the shoulder joint, which is formed between the head of the humerus and the shallow glenoid cavity of scapula. So while running through this quadrangular space, the axillary nerve is giving its first branch to the shoulder joint. So first branch is given to the shoulder joint. So the first branch from the trunk of axillary nerve is the shoulder joint. After giving a branch to the shoulder joint, it is immediately divided into anterior and posterior branch. If we take a transverse section along this plane, say over this plane, which is cutting across the quadrangular space. Then you get to see the following structure. This is the humerus at the level of the surgical neck, right? Deltoid muscle, cross section. Axillary nerve. Main trunk in accompaniment with the branches from the main trunk of axillary artery, which gives anterior circumflex humeral artery that wind around the anterior part of surgical neck of humerus, and another is the posterior circumflex humeral artery which wind around the posterior aspect of the surgical neck of humerus. Now immediately after giving the first branch to the shoulder joint, it divides into an anterior division. Let's say this is the anterior division, which passes along with the posterior circumflex humeral artery in between the surgical neck of humerus and the deltoid, and it provides branch to the deltoid muscular branch, and this muscular branch pass all over through the deltoid to supplying the overlying skin. So regarding the branches of the anterior division, it supplies the deltoid and overlying skin. So anterior division, it is supplying the deltoid and skin. Regarding the other branch, that is the posterior branch. The posterior branch is giving a branch to the teres minor muscle, also to the posterior part of deltoid, and continues as the upper lateral cutaneous nerve of arm, winding around the posterior aspect of deltoid muscle. So the posterior division is supplying the teres minor muscle, also it is supplying the deltoid posterior part as well, and continues as upper lateral cutaneous branch of arm. Okay. Now, this upper lateral cutaneous branch of arm, basically, it is passing round like this. Upper lateral cutaneous nerve of arm, and supplying the following territory: lower part of the skin over the lower part of the deltoid. So that is the cutaneous branch arising out of the deltoid. Then we also get the articular branch to the shoulder joint, and last but not the least, the muscular branch to the deltoid and tris minor. If there is injury to the axillary nerve, as often occur due to inferior dislocation of head of humerus or fracture in the region of the surgical neck, if there is fracture, then what will happen? There will be the damage of the axillary nerve, since it is very closely related to both of them. This is the axillary nerve. It is closely related to both the shoulder joint and surgical neck. So any lesion or any dislocation of the shoulder joint as well as fracture in the surgical neck will damage the nerve itself. And as a result of the damage of axillary nerve, there will be damage to the deltoid and teres minor. What will happen to the damage of deltoid? If deltoid is damaged, as deltoid is the principal abductor of the shoulder, then there will be impaired abduction of the shoulder. So deltoid damage will manifest as impaired abduction of the shoulder. So that is one point. Moreover, there is another important point, is that the deltoid is responsible for the rounded contour of the shoulder. This rounded contour of the shoulder is kept up by the deltoid. So if there is paralysis of deltoid, there will be shrinkage of deltoid, leading up to the loss of rounded contour of shoulder. And last but not the least, there will be loss of sensation over the lower half of the deltoid, as I have already told. That is due to the damage of the upper lateral cutaneous nerve. And usually over this area, there is the regimental badges of the military personnel usually hang over the area of the supply of the upper lateral cutaneous branch. So this area of loss of cutaneous sensation is usually called the loss of sensation in the regimental badge area. Regimental badge area. This is the regimental badge area. Loss of cutaneous sensation. So these are the important features: impaired abduction, loss of rounded contour, and there will be loss of sensation in the regimental badge area of the shoulder. So that is the applied aspect of injury of the axillary nerve. The brachial plexus is a nerve network that is arranged in the following manner. Starting from the roots, which are 5 in number, C5, C6, C7, C8 and T1, it led to the formation of trunks, which are 3. Upper trunk, middle trunk and lower trunk. Each of the trunk divide into two division, anterior and posterior division, and the divisions unite between them in a specific manner to give rise to cords. And there are 3 cords: the lateral cord, medial cord and the posterior cord. The musculocutaneous nerve is arising from the lateral cord. It runs downward and laterally and piercing coracobrachialis. This muscle is coracobrachialis muscle. It also supplies the coracobrachialis and then passes between biceps and brachialis. So after piercing the coracobrachialis, it further go downward and passes between the following two muscles. Above there is biceps and below the nerve lies brachialis. So biceps is lying above the nerve and brachialis is lying below the nerve. In between them two is the cut part of the biceps. In between these two muscles, sandwiched between them, the musculocutaneous nerve runs through the front of the arm. Thereafter, it appears at the lateral margin of the biceps tendon. Let's see. It appears on the lateral margin of biceps tendon. Appear on lateral margin of biceps. This is the biceps tendon. And pierces the deep fossa just above the elbow to continue downward over the lateral aspect of the forearm. So here it is piercing the deep fossa just above the elbow. Let's draw the elbow. And it descends over the lateral aspect of forearm as the lateral cutaneous nerve of forearm. So this is the lateral cutaneous nerve of forearm, which is the continuation of the musculocutaneous nerve. What are the branches and distribution? Let's see. The musculocutaneous nerve, having the root value of C5, C6 and C7 and coming from the lateral cord of brachial plexus, it first pierces the coracobrachialis. And supplies it. So that is the first muscular branch to coracobrachialis. Then in between the biceps brachii and brachialis it passes and supplies both of them. Brachialis and biceps brachii. These three muscles are supplied by it. Regarding the cutaneous branch, the cutaneous innervation is done by the lateral cutaneous nerve of forearm. So cutaneous supply is via the lateral cutaneous nerve of forearm that supply the skin on the front and lateral aspect of forearm. See, supplying the skin on the front and lateral aspect of the forearm. And last but not the least, the articular branch. it supplies a tweak to the elbow joint, a branch to the elbow joint, through its branch to the brachialis muscle. Okay. What are the clinical correlation? Though the injury of the musculocutaneous nerve is very rare, but it occur when it occurs, it leads to the following signs and symptoms. Number one, loss of strong supination due to injury to the biceps brachii, loss of strong flexion due to injury to the brachialis, and loss of sensation along the lateral aspect of forearm due to injury to the lateral cutaneous nerve of forearm. Okay, so what will be the effect of damage? Loss of flexion of elbow, loss of supination, and also loss of cutaneous sensation on the lateral aspect of forearm, as well as due to injury to the supply to biceps brachii, there will be loss of biceps tendon reflex.